Hi, I'm Pia. I'm an economic researcher and I teach macroeconomics. This video is about elasticity, more specifically the case of elasticity of demand. In this video, we're going to learn about elasticities focusing on the elasticity of demand. In order to do so, we're going to start by defining the concept of a perfectly competitive market. Then we will address elasticity and the use of relative indicators. This will allow us to develop the concepts of elasticity of demand and elasticity of supply, as well as their different types. With this content, you'll be able to understand how demand and supply respond to changes in other variables, mainly price. So let's begin. First of all, we need to begin by defining and constructing the market. A market consists of a group of buyers and sellers of a particular good or service. Those buyers are the ones who will confirm the demand, and the sellers will become the supply. Before addressing elasticity, it's very important to understand the meaning of perfectly competitive markets. What does this mean? First of all, it means there are plenty of buyers and sellers. This means that one individual consumer or producer will not generate significant changes in the market with its own behavior. This implies that firms can freely enter and exit the market. It also means that no one has power in this market, so all buyers and sellers are price takers. They do not have enough influence to change price or the market conditions. Also, all goods are identical or homogeneous, which means that the sellers produce the same product. So there is no distinctive feature in the products that generates influence among buyers. Are there goods that are more difficult for you to stop buying? Or is there a situation where price is not that relevant to you? For example, imagine you are really thirsty from taking a long walk. The weather is really hot and you still get some more blocks on your way back home. You see only one shop open, and you realize you're craving a bottle of water. A bottle is normally $1, but suppose it costs $5. Would you buy it anyway? And if it were $10? This example helps us to understand the concept of elasticity. Elasticity has many applications in economics, and its main point is to express the percentage change of a variable caused by a percentage change in another variable. In other words, it will be the relative response in one variable to a change in another. In this case, if we wanted to apply elasticity, it will be the percentage change of the bottles of water demanded due to the percentage change in the price for bottles of water. How much does your willingness to buy that bottle of water change as price starts to increase? Why are we expressing everything on percentage? This is because we are measuring things that have different units. In our example, we were mixing price with bottles of water. The thing we want to capture is how much did quantity change according to the price change. So the variation between each change is what will confirm the elasticity. And this allows us to compare two different variables with different units. A variable is called elastic when it shows substantial change with reference to changes in another. This occurs when the elasticity is higher than 1. If its change were slight, then it would be inelastic, and this happens when the elasticity is lower than 1. So let's start with the elasticity of demand. The elasticity of demand measures the response in the quantity demanded of a certain product due to a change in its price. This means that if the quantity demanded of a product is elastic, it will change substantially if price varies. And if it were inelastic, the quantity demanded wouldn't change very much with price variations. So how is it measured? It consists of dividing the percentage change in the quantity demanded of a certain product and the percentage change in its price. For example, suppose there is a 5% increase in the price for olive oil. And as a consequence, the demand for olive oil fell by 10%. In order to calculate the price elasticity, we have to divide the percentage change in the quantity demanded, that is 10%, by the percentage change in price, that is 5%. As a result, we obtain 2. This means that demand for olive oil is elastic because it's higher than 1. The elasticity establishes the slope of the demand curve. As the demand for a certain product becomes more elastic, the slope for the demand curve will be flatter. Look at the graphs. The first one on the left represents an elastic demand for a good. You may see that a big change in quantity comes from a smaller change in price. Then, a demand that's perfectly elastic results when elasticity tends to infinity. If a good has perfectly elastic demand, it means that the quantity demanded will change with no changes in price. This is represented as a horizontal line and illustrates extreme cases, such as luxury goods. Then we have unit elastic, which happens when elasticity is equal to 1. This means that the percentage change in price generates a percentage change in quantity in the same amount. As for inelasticity, the demand curve should become steeper. Can you see from the graph on the left that a big change in price generates a change in quantity, but smaller? Do you see the difference in those gaps? Look at the arrows. And finally, perfect inelasticity happens when there is no change in the quantity demanded when price changes. This is also an extreme case. Can you think of examples for perfect inelasticity? Those are very extreme cases, since the purest definition establishes that demand remains the same regardless of a price, like water or air. The closest goods that can be associated are those in which demand changes very little when prices fluctuate, such as tobacco or prescription medication. There are other types of demand elasticities. We have the income elasticity, which measures the change in quantity demanded as a response to changes in income. This elasticity is highly used in macroeconomics, since it captures what we call the marginal propensity to consume. In other words, it tells us how much will consumption change if income experiences a variation. We also have the cross-price elasticity of demand, which measures the change in the quantity demanded of one product as a response to changes in the price of another product. For this case, we're going to do a small exercise. Let's try to understand the concept of cross-price elasticity of demand. We just said that it measures the change in the quantity demanded of one good as to changes in the price of another. If those two goods are substitutes, would that elasticity be positive or negative? And what if they were complements? If for substitutes you arrived to the conclusion that the elasticity would be positive, then you are correct. A substitute good means that it has the same purpose of other products, so it can act as a replacement. If the price of a good changes, suppose it increases, and you can buy a similar product at the same original price, it is likely for you to buy the other one, isn't it? And for complements, the case would be the opposite. A complementary good, as opposed to the substitute, adds value to the other good. So it is more likely for those goods to be consumed together. For example, if razor blades' price increase, then the quantity demanded for shaving cream will be discouraged, so demand will fall. Now we have learned the elasticity of supply. This is quite similar to the price elasticity for demand, since it measures changes in the quantity supplied of a product due to changes in its price. Remember that we are referring to markets which are perfectly competitive, so all the firms are price takers. So, when calculating the elasticity of supply, the results are analogous. An elastic quantity supply means it changes substantially due to price variations, and it only changes slightly when it is inelastic. This will also determine the slope of the supply curve. Remember that the supply curve is positive, since quantity supplied, as opposed to demanded, has a positive relationship with price. The question is, how positive? Look at the graphs. The first one on the left represents an elastic supply for good. you may see that a big change in quantity comes from a smaller change in price. Then, perfect supply elasticity happens when elasticity tends to infinity. This is represented as a horizontal line. If price is set below PA, the quantity supplied would decrease to zero. Then we have unit elastic, which happens when elasticity is equal to one. This means that the percentage change in price generates a percentage change in quantity in the same amount. Inelasticity of supply also generates the curve to become steeper. Supply is inelastic when changes in price do not affect the quantity as much. And perfect inelasticity happens when there is no change in the quantity supplied when price changes. Can you think of examples for perfect elasticity and perfect inelasticity? Which are the most common mistakes? First of all, remember that a perfectly competitive market means that buyers and sellers do not have power and they are all price takers. Also, elasticity is measured as a percentage change because we are measuring things that have different units. Wrapping up, we've seen in this video that elasticity is the percentage change of a variable caused by a percentage change in another variable. The most used indicator is the price elasticity, which establishes the slope for the supply and demand curves in the market. Hope you have enjoyed this video, and also, if you want to learn more, feel free to explore more about the topic on Chegg.